Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. It is good to be in the house of God on tonight. Amen. On a Wednesday night. So thankful for the Lord. So thankful for God giving us the opportunity and the honor. I'm going to let you know up front, we're going to have somewhat of an abbreviated music and worship time here, because I have a lot that I have to go over, and it's going to be quite informational. So we'll have to take our time on that. But I thank God for the ability to be able to get into His Word and find out what His Word says about it. Amen. How many of y'all are glad that the Lord doesn't leave us ignorant, but He will let us know what His Word has to say? So we're going to go into His presence tonight, and we're going to worship. I hope that your hearts were ready as you got here. I hope that you were preparing yourself as you came here. And I hope you are ready to hear the word of the living God, amen, which is able to save our very souls, amen. And a lot of people will say, well, what does this have to do with anything? It has a lot to do with everything, all right? So we need to know it. Also, we're going to welcome in St. Louis. They are gathered right now in the sanctuary, and they are, amen. Amen, they're gathered right now, and they're ready to worship with us, and they're ready to hear from the Word of God. And so we thank God for that. But let's get our hearts and our minds ready, and we're going to hear the Word of God. We're going to hear the Word of God tonight, all right? You in St. Louis, get your heart and your mind ready. We're going to hear the Word of God tonight. Father, we thank You so much, Lord God, for the honor and the opportunity we have to be here tonight. We thank You for Your loving kindness and Your tender mercy, for it is with loving kindness that You draw us unto the wells of salvation. And we thank You, God, for this great well, God, that You have brought us to, Lord God, that we have drawn life from, God, that we have, Lord, that we have drawn restoration and reconciliation and our lives have changed, oh God. We thank You so much for this place. We thank You so much for the anointing. We thank You so much for Your presence. We thank You so much for the Word of God that's getting ready to go forth in this place. We ask, God, that You would just absolutely touch our minds, touch my heart, God, touch my mouth, that I would speak those things concerning Your Word, then touch all of our ears to hear what the Spirit would say unto the church tonight. Reach out through live stream, God. Touch somebody tonight, God. Encourage them, God. Educate them, God. Indoctrinate them tonight, Lord. This is what You would have us to desire, to be transformed by the renewing of our mind, God, that we may be able to prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So we pray that You would have Your way in this place tonight. Move according to Your pleasure. And we will give You praise and glory and honor for it all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Let's worship the Lord tonight.
Beauty that
Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Oh, we love you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, we love you.
This is the end. This is the air I breathe. Oh, I'm lost without you, Jesus. I'm lost without you, Lord. Oh, 'cause I'm desperate for you. Oh, Lord, I'm so lost without you, Lord. And I'm lost without you. Couldn't make it without you, Lord. And I, Lord, I'm so desperate.
I'm desperate for you.
I need you more than anything, Lord. More than anything, Jesus. And
me, that's your heart, just desperate for more of the Lord. Amen. Desperate for more of him. Amen. Lost without him. Amen. Glory to God. Well, you can have a seat in the presence of the Lord. Amen. So thankful for God's presence we feel in here, for God's anointing that we get to experience. We are a very blessed people, and I hope that we understand that. We really are. We got a long way to go tonight, and so I hope that you've got that biblical endurance about you, and you're ready to hear what the Spirit would say unto the church. This is an often misunderstood subject, and we need to understand what we're looking for and what we're looking at. And so we're going to talk tonight about the prophecy concerning Israel. Most of the time within Christianity, anytime anything is unsettled in the Middle East, immediately people think, "Oh, the Lord's going to come back right away. He's getting ready to split the eastern sky." And so we have to understand what the Word of God says about this in order to actually be able to gauge the times that we're in. The Bible said that there were men who were the sons of Issachar that were wise because they could discern the times so that they might be able to tell Israel what they ought to do. And it is so important in crucial times and in critical times like this that we understand where we're at in the time frame and in the Word of God. And I want you to understand that God loves Israel. He loves Israel. I mean, he loves Israel. And we're going to talk about how much he loves them. And I want you to grab your Bibles and go with me to Exodus, the fourth chapter. And we're going to start at the 22nd verse. And we've got so much scripture. I hope that you have brought your notebooks. If you don't, I hope that you have a photographic memory, and if you don't, I hope you go back and watch and write the scriptures down. The Bible says that we should be able to give an answer to every man that asketh of us of the reason of the hope that lies within us. My pastor said is not an adequate answer to doctrine. And so we have to know what the Word of God says. And I want this church to be a very well-educated church in the scripture. I want you to be able to take people to the Word of God and show them. But here in Exodus, the fourth chapter, starting at the 22nd verse, "And thou shalt say unto Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord, Israel is my son, even my firstborn." Now we know that this is not speaking of the monogenes, the only begotten of the Father. This is speaking concerning the people out of all of the nations that he isolated and separated unto himself. And he said, Israel is my firstborn. They are my son. And it shall come to pass, and I say unto thee, let my son go, that he may serve me. And if thou refuse to let him go, behold, I will slay thy son, even thy firstborn. This is how much God regards Israel. He said, if you don't, Pharaoh, let my son go. If you remember, the scripture says, out of Egypt have I called my son. Now, that is a prophecy also concerning Christ. But you're hearing the Lord here say himself, Israel is my son. Now, let him go that he can serve me. And if you won't let him go, I'm taking your firstborn. I'm taking your son. And that's how much God regards Israel, how much he loves her. If you go to Deuteronomy, the 7th chapter, and we'll start at the 6th verse of the 7th chapter. You just have to hear the words. And we're gonna talk about it here in just a minute, because God has not changed his feeling toward Israel. He said, for thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth. The Lord did not set his love upon you nor choose you because you were more in number than any people, for you were the fewest of all people. But because the Lord loved you, and because he would keep the oath which he has sworn unto your fathers, hath the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you out of the house of bondmen from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. The Lord said, I love you. You are special to me above all of the people of the earth. I didn't choose you because you were the greatest in number. In fact, in all reality, you were the least in number. But because I loved you, I delivered you out of the hand of the bondman. This is how dear Israel is still yet to God. He loves Israel. And there is a theological position that started decades ago called replacement theology. And in replacement theology, they taught that God had wholesale fully rejected Israel and had turned to the Gentiles completely. And we, as the Gentile church, replaced Israel. But that is not the word of God at all. If you go with me to Romans, the 11th chapter. And people say, do people really teach this stuff? I heard this teaching in many churches from when I was young, even going through preaching at other churches. I heard replacement theology oftentimes in the pulpits, but it's just not true. In fact, we were in a minister's meeting one time, and I had somebody ask me, we were talking about David having not ascended into heavens. We were speaking of the resurrection. And he said, so you think David is going to be in the kingdom? And I said, well, I sure do. And he was like, so you're telling me you think Old Testament saints are going to be in the kingdom? So we're saved by the law? And I was like, well, that's a foolish question, because Jesus said, when you see Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and the prophets standing in the kingdom of God, but you yourself thrust out, there shall be weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. So you may not believe they're going to be there, but Jesus does. But it is a result of replacement theology. It is this idea that somehow God despises Israel. But he doesn't despise Israel. Paul said here in Romans, the 11th chapter and the first verse, he said, I say then, hath God cast away his people? So Paul's asking the question, because obviously this is an idea that is maybe floating around. He's addressing an idea. He said, God forbid, for I also am an Israelite of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. I do want to remind us all that the first Christians were Jews. The first Christians were not Gentiles. In fact, the Gentiles did not come in till sometime later. And we thank God that we came in. But the people he chose first, he said, Israel have I foreknown. Those were his, that was his first son. That was his firstborn. Amen. We came in later, but Israel was his firstborn. So his firstborn was also the first partakers of the new covenant. So he said, has God forbid he had cast them away? He said, God had not cast away his people, which he foreknew. What ye not what the scripture saith of Elias, how he maketh intercession to God against Israel? Elijah was saying, they've killed all the prophets. Keep going, brother. He said, they've killed the prophets and digged down thine altars, and I am left alone, and they seek my life. But what did the Lord say? He said, I have reserved unto myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal. Even so, then, at this present time, there is a remnant according to the election of grace. And then he goes, if by grace, then it is no more works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. We'll go into that later. But the reality is there was a remnant of Israel that God saved. The rest of them blindly walked away. But there was a remnant of Israel that God saved. And I will tell you this, at the end of the age, there will be another remnant of Israel God will save. So God has not turned his back on Israel completely. Yes, has he cut them off? He sure has for a time. But Paul said, boast not against them. He said, for if God spared not his the natural branches, take heed lest he cut you out also. But he said, if they abide not in unbelief, God is able also to graft them back in. God is going to bring Israel back in. But they're going to have to go through some things to get there. They're going to have to go through some things to get there. Paul said, have they stumbled that they should fall away? God forbid. Israel's stumbling right now. And since Christ came, they stumbled. And they're walking around stumbling right now. We were talking about it when we went to New York for Christmas. There was an RV of Jewish proselytes. And they were going around and they were singing over the loudspeaker, we want Mashiach Ka, we want Mashiach Ka, and we don't want to wait. We want the Messiah, we want the Messiah, and we don't want to wait. And my heart broke for them because I thought he came unto his own. And his own received him not. He's already come. You don't have to wait. He's right here, right now, to all that call upon his name. And it broke my heart that they were crying out, we don't want to wait. We want him and we want him right now. And I thought all you have to do is call on his name. For he that calleth upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But they're blind. And they're blind because of unbelief. And Paul said, because of their blindness, the gospel was preached unto the Gentiles. So instead of us sitting there and ridiculing them and despising them, we should thank God that we have the opportunity to be able to hear the gospel also. Now, the question is, if you look at the Arabs, the Palestinians, and the other Arab nations that are surrounding Israel, and I should have put up a map tonight of the nations, but all around Israel. Israel has nowhere to go. If you look all around Israel, all of the nations that surround Israel, hate Israel.
They're Arab countries. I was talking to the children this week about Israel. And I said, you have to understand, there's no true Muslim
that is a peace-loving Muslim toward Jews and Christians. We are infidels. They hate us. And the only thing that they know to do is commit jihad or holy war upon us to destroy us. Because you have to understand, tonight Israel is reeling up under a horrible and heinous attack. But they hate us too, guys. And the same persecution that's coming toward Israel will come for the church. It will come for the church because we're infidels. But I want you to understand the Arabs did not occupy the land before Israel. In fact, the Muslim religion is centuries after the Jewish religion. Muhammad didn't come until centuries after Christ had resurrected. And so the Muslim religion really has no grasp on Israel. There's nothing there for them to actually own. There's no inheritance for them. God gave that land to Israel. Go with me to Joshua, the first chapter and the first verse. This is not something that they just ruthlessly went and inhabited. This is the gift of God. God gave. This is their inheritance. The firstborn of God among humanity, I'm going to give them an inheritance. And he told Joshua, of course, he starts out by saying, now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all this people, unto the land which I do give to them, even to the children of Israel. And every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that I have given unto you, as I said unto Moses. Now listen, from the wilderness of Lebanon, okay? If you look at the borders, these are the borders of Israel. Now they have taken borders that are beyond this just simply because of defense of themselves. Biblical history, where you see the Gaza Strip, that belonged to the Philistines. But they had to take that. The Golan Heights, yes, it may somewhat be in, there may be some argument about the Golan Heights, but you had people coming in into the Golan Heights, Hezbollah coming into the Golan Heights, which is a high place in Israel, and they're firing rockets into Israel. What do you expect them to do? What would we do if Canada started hurling rockets into the United States? We would go right up there and take whatever strategic advantage they have away from them to protect our country. But everybody wants Israel to leave all of it alone. They don't want them to take the West Bank. They don't want them to take the West Bank. Well, if you go in and occupy the West Bank, that's what they're calling them, occupiers and colonizers, as if the Arabs were there first. How insane is this? But this is indoctrination, saints of God, that goes way beyond anything that is even historically factual. He said, from the wilderness of Lebanon, even to the great river, the river Euphrates, which is Egypt. He said, even to there, it's yours. I've given it to you. Now, through the Mohammedans coming in and taking over conquest and taking over Israel and driving the inhabitants of Israel out of there. And then through all of the crusades of Catholicism, trying to recapture what they paid Muhammad to capture in the first place, and then he turns around and takes it to himself. That's all the crusades were. The crusades were not a loving action upon the Roman Catholic Church to seize back the Holy Land. They had paid Muhammad to go in and drive out the Jews. And then when he decided to keep it for himself, then the crusades start. Oh, we're going to take the Holy Land. That's because they were angry and wanted what they paid him to take. But Muhammad had no nativity of Muhammad in Jerusalem. There was no nativity of Muhammad in Israel. What did it matter? Later on years, now it's a folklore in the Muslim religion that Muhammad, I think even on a steer with wings, flew to God from the Temple Mount. What a bunch of ridiculous nonsense. But really, the headquarters of Islam is Mecca. That's the birthplace of Muhammad. And they still yearly make their trips to Mecca, make their pilgrimages to Mecca, and walk around his house. That's pretty much what they're doing. They're just walking around the place he was born. But really, Israel has nothing for them. But he hated the Jewish people because they would not receive his false indoctrination. And people say, well, if you read the Quran, he's peaceful. He's peaceful until he gets places where they don't accept his message. Read it. Oh, yeah, as long as you receive him, he's peaceful. The moment you're like, yeah, we're not going to accept that, yeah, cut their heads off. Let's commit jihad, holy war, kill the infidels. I want you to understand, there is no devout Muslim who does not love blood. They can't, or they wouldn't be devout. They want the blood of the infidels. They want the blood of the Jews. They want the blood. They want it. They want it. They desire the blood of men. It's a murdering horde is what it is. The Islamic religion is nothing but a satanic religion, and it's cloaked with religious pomp and circumstance, but it is satanic at its core. It is murder and blood and mayhem. And I'm not just blowing smoke, saints of God. Look at the history of the blood that was spilt at these wicked people because conquest was their goal. But the Lord said, I didn't give that to them. I gave that to Israel. So now after the Second World War, Jews in mass begin to make their way back to Israel. They begin to set up homes, and they begin to resettle the land. And of course, the Arab nations around them hate it. So what did they do? In 19, was it 67? Is that right? The Six-Day War? Is it 1962, 67, I think? But they rose up, and they were going to drive the Jews into the sea. But God said, I don't think so. And if you watch, there are documentaries where Islamic soldiers are talking about hands coming up out of the sand, talking about angelic forces standing before the armies of Israel as they progress. And they wouldn't even have to fire a shot. The Israelis wouldn't have to fire a shot all of a sudden as they're progressing toward these Islamic armies. They would just lay their weapons down and surrender. And it wasn't because of the might and the power of the Jewish army. It was because they were looking at angels. They were seeing angels. And the terror of those beings that were standing before them so struck fear in their heart that they just laid down their weapons and gave up. You tell me God's given up on Israel? And in 6 days, Israel did the impossible. In 6 days, they won a war against multiple. This little nation, who was just really budding at this time again. They're restarting. God empowers them to take possession of their homeland. So God gave it to them. Now I want to tell you something. You better be careful. And those of you that are watching, I am disgusted at the universities of this country. They are vile. They are not centers of education. They are centers of indoctrination. I'm talking about Christian schools. Harvard. Do you know what Harvard was started as? Harvard was a seminary. It was started to train ministers. And yet 30-some student bodies signed a proclamation declaring that it was Israel's fault for this attack of Hamas because they are colonizers and they are and they're sitting on land that doesn't belong to them, and they're oppressing the poor Palestinian people. 30-some student bodies within Harvard, 30-some organizations, student organizations, signed a proclamation to the point that it pushed Harvard's very liberal president to come out and say, you know what, we don't condone any of those statements. We don't condone violence or killing. But it took outcry for him even to come out and say it. Columbia University, same thing. Some of these student bodies had flyers made celebrating the attack on the colonizers. And you know what they had on their picture? The paraglider. Because paragliders went into a concert in Israel and killed 260 unarmed young people. But it's Israel's fault. And there was all over this country this weekend, there were Islamic demon-possessed people standing in the streets of our country, in New York City, in Washington, D.C. And when they went to interview them and they said, so you're telling me that these women and children that have been killed, it's their fault? They said, absolutely, they're colonizers. Do you know what a large portion of this country thinks that people of my complexion are? You think it's going to stop in Israel? No, it's not. No, it's not. Because in the universities of this country, all that's being taught to these young students is hate and rage. Hate and rage. It is systematic destruction of this country is what it is. They have infiltrated our universities, and they're doing nothing but poisoning the minds of young people against the United States of America, against people of my complexion. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Why? Because we need to dissettle the population. Because if we create chaos and confusion, we destroy the country. This is the reason why the church is so necessary. Nobody is denying the evil of history. But we cannot continue to eat the evil of history and expect that there be peace and love amongst people. You can teach history without teaching hate. So now, then we have these insane women in Congress. I mean, totally insane. Crying out that it's Israel's fault that Hamas did this. So it's Israel's fault that 40 babies have been killed and beheaded. I'm talking about infants beheaded. And that's Israel's fault. Children in their beds being gunned down. But that's Israel's fault. Come on, saints. They just wanted blood. It was blood they were after. It wasn't land. It wasn't property. They were after blood. They want blood. That's what Islam is. It's blood. It's blood. And we better understand it. And I don't care what old Francis says. The God of Islam is not the God of Christianity. Allah is Satan in disguise. You're not sending your children to higher education anymore. You're sending your children to higher indoctrination. And it's disgusting. And it's vile. We need to pray. I'm telling you, we need to pray for this country, and we need to pray. We need to pray that God will help people. If there has to be higher education and people need to go to universities for education, God, let universities will rise up and educate people and leave the indoctrination elsewhere. Amen. But they're pushing hate. And you Christians better get ready. Because Christianity is the problem in this country. And that's what they're being taught. Christianity is the evil in this country. If we can just eradicate Christianity, then we can have peace, because Christianity is the only one crying out against homosexuality and transgenderism and identity confusion and all of these things. We're the ones that still having a backbone to say something about it. And we're the problem now. We're the evil. Don't think for a moment that we are not the target. Amen. So we have to understand that we're not on the verge of Christ coming, because Christianity as a whole is not under the persecution that it is going to find itself in. Go with me to Matthew 24. We're going to talk about some end times, and then we're going to keep moving. I'm still going to talk about Israel. I just want us to kind of, I'm trying to ball this up to where at the end we understand where we are. But if you go with me to Matthew 24 and verse 1. Let's actually start at verse 3. He sat upon the Mount of Olives, and his disciples came to him privately, saying, "Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall the sign of thy coming and the end of the world?" They asked him the question. Jesus is about to answer the question. He says, "Take heed that no man deceive you." And one, I don't want you to be deceived about this. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. It doesn't mean necessarily that people will come saying that they are Jesus. It just means that they'll come affirming me, but they will deceive you by their words. They're going to preach Jesus, but it's a whole nother Jesus. And he said, and you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. Okay, we've got Russia now in a war with Ukraine. We've got Israel in a war with Islam. They're not in a war with Hamas. They're in a war with Islam. Don't make any mistake about it. They're in a war. China is going to go to war inevitably with Taiwan. We're hearing wars, rumors of wars. He said, see that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass. But the end is not yet. So when you see conflict breaking out in the countries and in the world, Christ is not going to imminently return. As long as there are wars and rumors of wars, the end has not come yet. He said, for nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there'll be famines, there'll be diseases, that's what pestilences, earthquakes in many different places, in diverse places. Afghanistan, I think, has had 3 earthquakes in the past week. There are rumblings, but saints, we're not there yet. We're not there yet. There are little rumblings happening right now. We're not there yet. Now, I'm not saying any of this to put you at ease. I'm saying this to put you on notice. Because even though the imminent return of Christ is not at hand, he is going to come back. And the only thing that's going to outlast you is what you did for him. Amen. Somebody said, well, it's what he did for me. Well, that's very pious. I appreciate your religious stance there. But ultimately, he did everything for me so that I would live for him. So I would serve him, so that I would walk before him, so that I would fulfill the calling and the purpose that he has given to me. He said, these are the beginning of sorrows. Then they shall deliver you up to be afflicted and shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended and shall betray one another and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. Paul talks about that in 2 Thessalonians, by the way. He said they're sending out letters fraudulently as if it came from us that the Lord is going to return at any moment. He said, don't pay attention to that. Don't pay attention to that. Because there are things that must be fulfilled before the coming of the Lord. He said, and I believe when he's talking about being afflicted and shall kill you, he's talking about the church. Because he's not foreseeing his apostles being Jewish rabbis. These are going to be the apostles of the new covenant. These are going to be the drivers of Christianity. And so he's dealing with what's going to happen to Christianity. And he said, and many false prophets shall rise and deceive many, and because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Because Christianity is going to be in such a place of lawlessness that many people who love God fiercely, their love is going to become cold. We're seeing that. The great falling away is the easy believism that they call eternal security. It is this idea that as long as I have professed the name of the Lord with my mouth, that I am saved, and regardless of what I do, I cannot be lost. What an incredible deception. And he said, because of that iniquity abounding, because of that lawlessness abounding among my people, many who loved me fiercely are now going to wax cold in their love. But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. And the gospel of this kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And then, everybody say then. If you're in St. Louis, say then. Everybody say it, then. Then shall the end come. So all of these things must transpire before the end comes. They're not happening in totality yet. So we're not looking for the imminent return of Christ. What this should do is provoke us to action, because there's time still left on the clock. It should shake us. I believe the Lord allows things like we're seeing in the Middle East with Israel, like we see with Ukraine. I believe he lets us see these natural disasters, these epidemics happen, to shake his people out of complacency and to spur them to action so that we will serve the Lord. And so we have to understand that. We have to understand that all of this is happening. We're seeing stuff take place that Jesus says the end's not yet. The end's not yet. The end's not yet. I also want us to talk about the rise of anti-Semitism. It is a powerful movement going on right now. And this is allowing us to understand where we really are on the time clock. It is the hatred of Jews. And there is an absolute, undeniable hatred of the Jewish people in this earth. They hate them. They despise them. If take for instance, if an unarmed black man gets killed, the whole nation rages. Somebody goes into a mosque and shoots up a bunch of Jews. Nobody hardly talks about it because it doesn't matter. They're seen as roaches, less than. The same anti-Semitic mentality that was in Germany is now beginning to absolutely spread worldwide. They were before the Sydney Opera House just yesterday crying, "Gas the Jews." Huge numbers of people. "Gas the Jews." Taking them right back to the Holocaust of Nazi Germany. Gas them. Gas them Jews. And if you're not careful, saints of God, your children are going to hate them. If you don't teach them about God's love for them, they will hate them. Because you let them get out of this church school. You let them be in a public school for any length of time. We may be some conservative around here right now, but it's not taking very long, and we're turning this thing too. Your children, if you're not careful, they'll go in and get higher indoctrination. And they'll come out hating Christianity. They'll come out hating the Jews. They will come out with anti-Semitism and an anti-Christian ideology. Why? Because we are the enemy. Who are we the enemy of? We're the enemy of Satan. And he hates us. And he hates the Jews. He hates anything that is truly tied to the one true God. He hates them. And he wants their destruction. And so he sends his teachers into colleges. He sends his preachers into the church. And all of a sudden, anti-Semitism is beginning to run rampant across this world. Immediately, right after Hamas attacked Israel, Alexandria Cortez stands up and says, "We need a ceasefire." Do you know what she's saying? She's saying Hamas should be able to do what they want. Israel shouldn't be able to respond. Immediately. Omar. Ian, is that her name? Ian Omar? That's not her first name. What's her first name? Huh? No, that's Rashida Tlaib. But Omar comes out and says, "We need a ceasefire. You can't oppress people like the Jews have oppressed the Palestinians and not have to pay the price for it." You know who provides water and power to the Palestinians? The ones that just cut it off. If Israel hated them so much, they wouldn't have power and water. That's where they get their power and water. We have a government that is so corrupt that even though Hamas came out and publicly thanked Iran for the part they played in helping them to carry out that tragedy and that atrocity on Saturday, our government officials are standing up going, "We have no credible evidence that Iran was involved in this at all." Want to know why? Because there's $6 billion in their hands. Not only that, because we lifted sanctions off Iran that allowed them to sell their oil, and billions of dollars flowed into Iran, who is the single greatest sponsor of terror in the world. So who do you think helped finance that attack? The United States of America and this current administration don't want to own up to it because they are at fault. So instead of them sitting there and saying, we condemn Iran for having any part in this, they go, we really don't see any of it. I don't see Iran in any of this. And Hamas thanked them publicly. And Hamas is an absolute total arm of Iran. They're a military, just like Hezbollah is. Who do you think they get their money from, their weapons, their tactical assignments? Who do you think they get all that from? Hamas would have never done what they did unless Iran gave them permission to do it. But our government is sitting back going, Iran? Well, yeah, they're bad, but I don't think they had anything to do with this. No credible evidence. Hamas thanking them for it. And how stupid would Hamas be to throw Iran, who's financing them, under the bus? And the Ayatollah from Iran said, we kiss the hands of those who killed the Jews. No credible evidence at all. Nothing to do with it. But do you see how anti-Semitic everywhere is being? We're excusing murderers. Wisconsin, the University of Wisconsin in Madison, students not a protest, but rather a gathering to celebrate Hamas, declared plainly they were celebrating the murderers. The murderers. Celebrating the murderers. They didn't say the conquerors, the warriors. They called them for what they are, murderers, and they said, we celebrate that. Because they're killing Jews. Who cares? This is the vile nature of anti-Semitism that is pervading our current culture all around the world. Demonstrations in support of Hamas. Hamas, who raped women and killed them in front of their children, who ripped children, babies, infants out of the arms of their mothers and decapitated them. This country is like, oh, people in this country going, oh, we are celebrating them. What kind of monsters cuts the heads of children off? Babies. But it's just Jews. Who cares? They got what's coming to them. And in some of the more prejudiced churches, they say, well, they killed Jesus. Well, there's no denying that they were absolutely in support of the Roman execution of Jesus. They put him up to do it. But Jesus didn't say, God, kill them all. He said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. He loved Israel. Jesus didn't hate the Jews. He said, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I would have gathered you under my wings as a hen gathers a brood, but you would not. He lamented. He loved them. So we better be careful that in our children and in our hearts and in our churches, this anti-Semitic ideology does not come to us. Because it's everywhere. It's everywhere. But it has to be. And I'm going to show you in Scripture why this has to happen. This spirit, this spirit that is working in the children of disobedience, this self-same spirit, has to grow. After this, there'll be no pity for the Jews. There'll be no mourning in the streets of any country for the Jews. You know what will happen is they're going to go in to Gaza and they're going to start tearing some folks up. They're going to lay waste to Gaza, and they have given the Palestinians in Gaza days now to get out. But those cowardly terrorists are using Palestinian people as human shields. You know what's going to happen? Israel's going to take 360,000 troops, and they're going to go into Gaza, and they're going to lay siege on Gaza, and they're going to start wiping out terrorists. And do you know what this country's going to start doing? They're going to start screaming for tolerance and let's back off. This is too much. We occupied a country for 20 years because they took credit for tearing down our towers. But within days, I promise you, if not weeks, the countries of this world and the governments of this world are going to start crying out against the government of Israel and saying, okay, that's enough. Okay, now we need to start talking about a truce here, a peace. And I'm telling you, Bibi Netanyahu ain't going to have nothing to do with it. He's going to go in and wipe everybody out he has to. And we will hate them for it. We will despise them for it. I was watching some of the press of what is her name? Corinne Jean-Pierre, I think is what her name is, the White House press secretary. And one of the Arab reporters said, didn't ask, you know, what are we doing to support Israel? You know what his question was? When are we going to start holding Israel accountable for the human atrocities that are going right now in their counteroffensive against the Palestinian people? Already, within days, a reporter followed Rashida Tlaib through her office into an elevator asking her, are you going to condemn these terrorists for what they've done to the women and the babies? She would not answer them. Because she doesn't condemn them. She is a Palestinian nativity, and she's not going to condemn a thing they do. That's in our Congress. That's in our Congress. Celebrating it. Black Lives Matter posters with the hang gliders. Celebrating the massacre of 260, by the way, not white people. The Jews are not white folk. But they celebrated it because they're just Jews. We are for the freedom of oppression for all people of color except the Jews. I'm glad they're dead. Because hypocrisy abounds in this country. It abounds in this world. Because the people, I'm telling you, the most vulnerable people in the near future are going to be Jews and Christians. You better get yourself ready for it. And all this war is doing is setting up a trial against Israel. It won't matter the atrocities that were committed against them. All that people will be crying out against is the response. But this has to happen. This has to take place. Go with me to Joel, the third chapter. Starting at the first verse, and this is the reason why I told you all, even on Sunday, that the last day outpouring of the Spirit of God is tied to the end times. It's not, that was a precursor. Pentecost was a precursor. It was a foreshadowing. But the real outpouring of the Spirit of God upon all flesh is going to happen at the end of the age. So you go out of Joel 2 and right into Joel 3, which, by the way, the Bible was not written in chapter and verse. I just want to make sure you understand that. For behold, in those days and in that time, when I shall bring again the captivity of Judah and Jerusalem, it's going to come again. They're going to go into captivity. They have not experienced their final captivity. This will happen. And I will also gather all nations and bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat. There is no valley of Jehoshaphat, but Jehoshaphat means the judgment of God. And will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered amongst the nations and parted my land. It's going to come again to them. It's going to happen. And they have done, listen to this. This is how harsh the anti-Semitic spirit is at the end of the age. They have cast lots for my people. They've sold them. And there's such hatred toward them that if a guy wants to spend the night with a harlot, if he owns one of the Jewish boys, he just sells the boy to the harlot. Wants a glass of wine? Sell one of their girls. That's how much the hatred is. They're nothing. They're commerce. They're commerce. But see, all of these people that know the atrocities of even slavery of the past of this country, they'll celebrate this, even though the same thing happened to people of their heritage. Because it will not matter, because they're just filthy Jews. It won't matter. That same indoctrination of Adolf Hitler will come into the hearts of this generation, and they'll hate them. They're roaches. They're the garbage of this world. They're the problems of this world. And Christianity is going to be playing right there in the same pool. We're going to have to face the same stuff. But that's how powerful the anti-Semitic ideology will be at the end of this age. We're going to capture them. We're going to divide their land. And when we capture them, we're going to sell their people. And if I just want a good night with a harlot, here's a boy. Here's one of their boys. If I want a glass of wine, you know what? This girl will get me at least a glass of wine, right? Can you imagine that, selling a human life for a drink of wine? But that's where we're headed. Yea, and what have ye to do with me, O Tyre and Zidon, and the coast of Palestine? Will you render me a recompense? And if ye recompense me swiftly and speedily, will I return in recompense upon your own head? Because you have taken my silver and my gold and have carried into your temples my goodly pleasant things. The children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem have ye sold unto the Grecians, that ye might remove them far from their border. Behold, I will raise out of the place where ye have sold them, and will return your recompense upon your own head. And I will sell your sons and your daughters into the hand of the children of Judah, and they shall sell them into the Sabians, into a people afar off. God said, in other words, you're going to face the same judgment. You're going to be in captivity. You're going to be in captivity because of the hatred that you have shown toward my people. And he says down here, he says in verse 16, he said, or let's go to verse 13. This is out of the book of Revelation. Put ye in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come get you down, for the press is full. The fats overflow, for their wickedness is great. That's in the book of Revelation. This is a prophecy concerning the end of the age. He said, look, I'm going to put the sickle in, because there's two reapings in the book of Revelation. You have the resurrection, and then you have the reaping of ungodly humanity, where he's going to press them out. He's going to call them down into the wrath of the winepress, of the fierceness of the wrath of Almighty God, and he's going to kill them right there in the valley of Megiddo. He said, then the Lord shall roar out of Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem. And the heavens and the earth shall shake, but the Lord will be the hope of his people and the strength of his children of Israel. This is all happening at the end of the age. But they're going to have to suffer, and there's a reason why they have to suffer. See, the Lord loves his children. When I tell you all that the Lord loves whom he chastens, you're about to find out the lengths he will go. He will go to dreadful lengths to get his children to turn toward him and to call on him. Go with me to Revelation, the 16th chapter. I'm just showing you how Joel is a prophecy of Revelation. The 16th chapter. The 14th verse, for they are the spirits of devils working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of the great day of God Almighty. He said, I'm going to bring you down into the valley of Jehoshaphat, and I'm going to plead right there with you for my people. And I want to tell you, he's not begging anybody. When he means plead there, he means I'm going to wipe you out. I'm going to destroy you. I'm going to put a hurting on you. We'll just put it that way for the young folks. This is also seen in Zechariah 14. And I want to tell you this. Don't shelter your children from this. Because if you will not teach them, the world will. I hear so many parents, well, I don't want to talk about that. I can't handle that. I don't want to talk about that. What are you talking about? Are you that emotionally immature that you can't handle this? I just would encourage you to grow up. And I'm not being mean when I say that. You talking about this day coming on you as a thief? If you don't know what's coming on us, this day is going to take you by surprise, and that's going to be an awful day for you. You've got to know this stuff. You need to teach your children this stuff. You can't shelter them from this. You can't hide this from them. But he says here in Zechariah, the 14th chapter, starting at the first verse, he said, "Behold, the day of the Lord cometh, and thy spoil shall be divided in the midst of thee. For I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle, and the city shall be taken." Listen to this. This is what's going to happen to them. "And the houses rifled, and the women ravished." We're just seeing that in part. That was a very small incursion as it compares to what will happen at the end of the age. "And the women ravished, and half of the city shall go forth into captivity, and the residue of the people shall not be cut off from the city." So ultimately, children of God, you're going to see God allow the armies of this world to come down, and you're going to watch them. You're going to watch them engage Jerusalem. You're going to watch them go into Jerusalem. You're going to watch them rifle the houses. They're going to ravish the women. They're going to take people into captivity. And you say, why would a loving God allow this to happen to people he loves? Because he has purpose. Whom he loves, he chastens, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. He said here, and he said, "Then shall the Lord go forth and fight against those nations as when he fought in the day of battle." We know that this is the end of the age. The Lord is going to come out of his place. I'm not talking about symbolically. I'm not talking about metaphorically. Jesus is coming, guys. And 10,000s of his saints are going to be with him. And we are going to do some warfare in the Valley of Megiddo, in Armageddon, which is the Valley of Megiddo. Now listen to this. "Then shall the Lord go forth and fight against those nations as when he fought in the day of battle." And who's he fighting for? He's not fighting for Christianity here. He's not fighting for the church. He's fighting for Israel. That's who he's fighting, because we're in the sea of glass at this point. He's fighting for Israel. The reason why he comes with his saints is to deliver the children of Israel that will call on his name. That's why he's coming. And he said here, "And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem on the east, and the Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst thereof toward the east." His foot, the foot of the Lord, is going to land upon the Mount of Olives. This is not metaphorical. He's literally coming. He said, "If I go away, I will come again." He's coming, saints. He will come for the church as a savior, as a redeemer, to redeem us from the body and to catch us up. He'll come for us as a husband comes for his bride. But when he comes for Israel, he's not coming as a husband for his bride. He's coming as a man of war. That's the reason why you need to get this fuzzy-headed, rainbow-wearing Jesus who walks around smoking peyote, singing kumbaya out of your head. That is not who he is. He said, "I saw him, and he was sitting on a horse, and he was his vestments were dipped in blood. On his thigh was written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And out of his mouth comes a sharp two-edged sword by which he smites the nations." He's coming back as a general over a great army. Amen. That's the reason why they can have all their fun right now. Soon enough, the Lord is going to deal with this. Go with me to the 13th chapter of Zechariah. "Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, against the man that is my fellow, saith the Lord of hosts. Smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall scatter." We know that is a prophecy of Christ as well. "And I will turn my hand upon the little ones. And it shall come to pass that in all the land, saith the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die." You've got a whole two parts. They're going to be cut off and die. "But the third shall be left therein." At the end of the age, whoever is remaining in Jerusalem, two-thirds of them are going to be wiped out. A third of them is going to remain. And ultimately, we see a number in in the book of Revelation that could represent that number, and that is 144,000. That could be the final number out of all of the millions of Jews that exist in this time frame. This could be the number that is left that God will save, that God will save, that he'll seal upon their foreheads. Touch not the earth, nor the trees, nor the water. Don't touch any of the living creation until I seal my servants in their foreheads. Well, before that happens, saints of God, there's got to be 144,000 of them that are saved, that are sealed. But the reality is two-thirds of them. Can you imagine that? They're going to take them into captivity. They're going to kill two-thirds of them that are remained after that, and then only a third will be left. Oh, why? Why, Lord, would you do that to them? He said, and I will bring the third part through the fire and will refine them as silver is refined and will try them as gold is tried. They shall call on my name. That's why he's doing it. After they've suffered, after they've went through all they've went through, God has given them all the help that he's going to give them. He sends them miraculous encounters, those that will preach to them. He sent them his own son. He said, I am not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But there comes a point that after they have suffered all of this, that enough is enough. And when enough becomes enough, he said, they shall call on my name. And I will hear them. And I will say, it is my people. And they shall say, the Lord is my God. They're going to call on that name. The only name. There's only one name. Given unto heaven by which we must be saved. They're going to call on the name of Jesus. And when they do, God help all of the armies of this world. Because the Lord is going to come out of his place. And he's going to fight against them as he fought in the day of battle. And it will be over for all of the heathens who think that oppressing and persecuting and murdering and slaughtering Jewish people is the fad of the day. That's what should happen. All of these heathens out here running around, crying out against Israel, celebrating Hamas, crying out against Israel, calling them the occupiers, even though the Lord gave them that land, which predates Muhammad coming in. In fact, Muhammad drove them out. See, your children aren't going to be educated to that if you take them into higher learning. They're going to be taught that the Jews are the occupiers. They're the ones that came in and took the land out of the hands of the Muslims. The devil is a liar. God gave that to them. God gave that to them. That is their inheritance. Go and possess the land which I have given unto thee. He gave them the land. They're not the occupiers. The Muslims were the occupiers. The Muslims were. Not the Jews. That was their land. That was rightfully theirs. But see, this is the reason why you have to teach your children from the Word of God. And around here in our schools, we don't whitewash history and we don't brownwash history and we don't blackwash history. It is what it is. There are things that have happened historically that are atrocious to all kinds of peoples around the world. We don't wash that stuff to make it seem history is all good and golden and wonderful. Sister Chandra does a great job educating your children, even to some hard things. But see, the West Coast academia wants to take the Holocaust out of the books of the public education centers. Why? Because if your children don't know about it, ask your kids how much, if your children have attended public school at any time, ask them how much they hear about the Holocaust. Ask them. If they hear about it at all, it's in passing. I've talked with young people and they said, what do you mean Holocaust? I said, I'm talking about when Hitler, who was the dictator of Nazi Germany, the chancellor of Nazi Germany, took 6 million Jews and exterminated them. Men, women, and children. Such hatred for babies that they would take water hoses and they would put them in the stomachs of babies and fill their bellies up with water. And the soldiers got entertainment by jumping on the bellies of the babies. to watch the water explode from the children. Your children are not going to hear that, I'm telling you. If they hear it now, it won't be many years and they will not hear it in the public sector. Why would they take that out? So they can do it again. Because if you forget history, history will repeat itself. They don't want your children to know it. They don't want them to know of the evil atrocities that happened to the Jewish people. They don't want them to know that. They don't want them to know that. That the Germans were so desensitized, so hardened and callous against the Jews, that when they were burning them in the ovens of the concentration camps and human skin was falling on them from the sky, they were absolutely unmoved. But I wonder how many children will hear about this stuff anymore, because they want to do it again. And I'm going to tell you, Christianity is also the target. But why is he doing that? To purge us, to purify us, to make us white. That's why he'll let that happen to the church. He'll let persecution come to the church. He'll let the tribulation come to the church, which is the persecution of the church, not the wrath of God against the world. It is the persecution. The great tribulation is the persecution of the church. The vials of the wrath of God are a whole different subject. We have not been reserved under wrath, but to obtain salvation. But God will have to purge the church, because he has to present it to himself, a glorious church, without spot, without blemish, without wrinkle, holy and without blemish, or any such thing. He has to purge us. So we also will go through the fire, but so will the Jews. But the end result is salvation. So I don't want you thinking, oh, well, you see what's happening in Israel, the Lord could return tonight. He cannot. And you say, well, God can do anything. No, he can't. He cannot cross his word. He has set out the parameters of what must happen before his return. And he's not going to cross that word. But I am so glad. I am so glad that he's going to cut that work short in righteousness. So that even the elect, the Bible said if he didn't, no flesh would be saved. No flesh would be saved. But I'm so glad that he's going to cut his work short in righteousness. I'm so glad that I have hope today. I'm so glad that regardless of the events that are transpiring around this ungodly world, around this heathen world, that I, children of God, and that you, children of God, have great hope. And we have great things to look forward to. There is a great move of God coming yet to the church. There is a last great outpouring that is going to take place amongst God's people. And the glory of the latter house is going to be greater than the glory of the former house. And people talk about the latter rain, but he said, I will send to you the former and the latter rain together. Hallelujah. He is going to send a deluge of his power and his glory into the church. And your sons and your daughters are going to be affected. But that's the reason why you have a present responsibility to keep them as much as you can separated from the things of this world, so that nothing of this world has an attachment on them that would remove them from the presence of God when God begins to pour out his spirit. Because if you will take the necessary diligence now, if you will do the necessary diligence now, your sons and your daughters will prophesy. This world's children will not prophesy, but your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Amen. Hallelujah. Young men will dream, will see vision. Old men will dream dreams. So we've got great things to look forward to. The Lord is going to return. Amen. We're going to have to go through some purging. We're going to have to go through the fire. We're going to have to. We're going to have to deal with some of these things. But at the end of it, we'll be pure. We'll stand before the Lord. The Bible said that he saw that this army, this great army following Christ. And he said they were clothed in white, and the white is the righteousness of the saints. Whew, glory to God. And I'm going to tell you something right now, children of God. This world can hate us now. They can hate us all they want to now. They can persecute all they want to now. They can kill and maim and murder, because even in Europe right now, I can't remember the country, but there is a great persecution against Christianity. In that over 150,000 Christians have been displaced from their country and are now refugees in a neighboring country, because they came in and drove them out. They persecuted them. Oh, the Middle East, these peace-loving Muslims who just love people. They're just peace-loving people who are crucifying Christians upside down and persecuting them in Asia and in the Middle East. Oh, yes, they're peace-loving. No, they're bloodthirsty. They are animals is what they are. People can say whatever they want. They are bloodthirsty animals. That's all they are. They're out for destruction, and they're out to maim and harm people who disagree with them. You know what? The LGBTQ community, they can say whatever they want to about Christianity. We won't cut your head off for being a homosexual. We won't push you off of a building for being a homosexual. But why is it that that's we're the target? Why is Christianity the target of the alphabet community? Why are we the target? Why? When Muslims are beheading homosexuals. When they're castrating homosexuals, they're taking homosexuals on high-rise buildings and casting them off. You don't hear the LGBTQ community saying, oh, well, you know, them evil Muslims out there. It's them horrible, judgmental Christians. Because it's the same God working with the same spirit in them all. And the God of this world is Satan. Why do you think they're not crying out against Islam? They're not saying a word about him because they have the same God. And the Bible says the kingdom of Satan is not divided. But you let the church say something about homosexuality. Self-righteous, judgmental, homophobic. Let the church say something. But I hadn't seen a Christian cut off the head of a lesbian or a homosexual in my entire lifetime. But come out as a homosexual in an Arab country, especially those who are heavily engaged in Sharia law, see what happens to your fabulous self. They will end your life right then and right there. But I bet your children don't hear about that. I bet you the higher education or higher indoctrination universities of this country and around this world aren't telling the young people that. You say, Brother Jerrod, are you against higher education? Nope, I'm against higher indoctrination. It'd be better for you to send your children to a trade school than to send them to a university and come back hating your God, hating your faith, and hating God's people. We sent one of our children to a Christian college, and they came back so indoctrinated it blew my mind. To a Christian college in a little bitty town in a mountain of North Carolina. North Carolina. Mountains of North Carolina. Literally an hour from here. And they came back so indoctrinated I didn't even know who they were. I was like, what is this person? And they were only there for a few months. But that's what your universities will do. So applaud the universities all you want. Celebrate higher education. But you better make sure that when your children come home, you have so indoctrinated them in the Word of God. They have such an incredible biblical foundation that none of those things would move them. Because saints, we're in dangerous territory. How in the world in this country? And I'm all First Amendment. People can say whatever they want. But how could we have such vitriolic hatred toward a people? 260 young people and thousands of others killed, maimed, and murdered. Amongst them, 40 babies, of whom many of them were beheaded. And people in this country and in universities around this country and people around the world are okay with it. Something is afoot, saints. And we better get real busy finishing this thing. Because the only hope people are going to have is within the house of God. The only place they're going to find love. And I mean true love. I'm not talking about that sick, sadistic, narcissistic, codependent love of the world. I'm talking about the real love of God is in the house of God. Amen. And I know people despise when I talk about, oh, we need to come out of the world and we should have no fellowship with the world and blah, blah, blah. And they say, oh, that's so horrible and judgmental. I mean, God wants you to live your best life. I mean, really, all things are lawful for me. But he's not talking about sin being lawful. Paul said, should we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How is it you who are dead to sin can live any longer therein? People get mad when I talk about things like Halloween or the commercialization of Christmas. When I cry out against old Santa Claus. When I say something about the Easter Bunny. Christians. I'm not even talking about world. I expect the world to do that. But Christians come out. Wow, it's so judgmental. Because, you know, having the harvest festival where your children dress up in costumes where they have trunk or treat is definitely not the same thing as Halloween. I mean, it's not. Especially if you dress them up as biblical characters. People get mad at me. You're just being judgmental. Listen, your children are not going to miss one thing. If they can't dress up like a Chucky, if they can't dress up like who's Elsa and go out from door to door and say trick or treat and get candy, they're not going to die. They're not going to spontaneously combust. They're not going to implode upon themselves. I want to tell you, I was in Walmart just yesterday, and there's a whole candy aisle that is dedicated to candy that is there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. And if you are so tore up about your children getting candy, wait till the 1st of November. Give them about $20. Wait a minute, we're in inflation. Give them about $40. Give them about $40 and send them down the candy aisle at Walmart and let them rot their blessed teeth out. But it is not going to end their life if they can't celebrate Halloween. There's no redeeming quality to it for us. People say, well, Pastor Jerrod, are you going to be at your house and are you going to be passing out candy on Halloween? Nope. I'm putting Jehovah Witness tracks all over my porch. Glory to God. I'm not. But I just ignore it. It doesn't mean anything to me. I didn't celebrate Yom Kippur. Didn't mean anything to me. Has nothing to do with me. I don't go to any other country and celebrate their stuff because it doesn't mean anything to me. Halloween has nothing to do with me as a Christian, so I just act like it's not there. Well, aren't you afraid that people won't feel like you're being relatable? And no. No. Well, what are you going to do if a child comes up to your door and knocks on your door and asks for a piece of candy? I'm not going to answer the door. If I do, I'm going to give them a flyer for church. Doesn't mean anything to me. Why are we so tore up about Halloween, saints? Why are folks so tore up about this? Like, we've had people leave our church over Halloween. Leave our church. Well, if he preaches against Halloween again this year, I'm never going back. They went out from us. Because they were not of us. For had they been of us, surely they would have remained with us. Saints of God, it doesn't have anything to do with us. The origins are deeply rooted in Celtic mysticism and demonic rituals. And it's heavily, heavily fortified. The foundation of Halloween is absolutely wicked. It's totally evil. There's nothing good about it. There's no Christian. People say, well, you celebrate Christmas. Well, I don't celebrate it like the world does. I use Christmas as an opportunity to preach Jesus. Amen. But what if your children get up on Christmas morning and there's not 500 presents underneath the tree? Then I have money in savings. I didn't go spend all my money in savings. I didn't go get a loan, and I didn't use all my credit cards. I don't mind you buying a present or a gift for your children, but make sure it has something to do with Christmas, with the birth of Christ. I mean, my goodness gracious. That's why we're celebrating, right? Oh, come on, Christians. Well, I celebrate Christmas because I just love the acknowledgement of the birth of Jesus. You know, here's Resident Evil, honey. Hope you enjoy. Here's your latest Taylor Swift shirt. Go tell it on the mount. Has nothing to do. Has nothing to do with us. They interviewed Jelly Roll and they said that Jesus, he said the Jesus of the Bible is dying in the church. And I said, I don't care what you think. But Christians, that's what they do. Let a superstar get up. Let a preacher who's been studying the Word of God for years, been laying down their life for the church for years, let him stand up and preach biblical truth. And the people will sit there and go, that is so self-righteous. Doesn't he understand we are in an era of grace? Let Jelly Roll get up and talk about how mean we are to lesbians, and they sit there and go, preach on, Jelly Roll. I mean, Jelly Roll was a snack cake I used to eat back in the day. It is not my source of doctrine. Going to get so much on this. That's all right. We have to come back to the church. We need to come back to the ministry. We need to get out of the world. We need to stop listening to all these people. They don't love your God. They don't serve your God. I don't care if they stand up and say, I want to thank my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, for this Grammy. The fact that they talked about girls shaking their behinds, about shooting up people, about fornication and adultery. Come on, somebody. But they thank Jesus Christ for the Grammy. It's not your Jesus. I don't let filthy music. I don't even let secular music go on in my home. Chandra, do we listen to secular music in our home at all? Zero. It's not on my radio. Somebody said, well, I just like some country western. It gets me there. It gets you where? It's all about how your dog hates you and your wife left you because you cheated on her and now you're in the bar. They say if you take a country western record and you turn it backwards and play it backwards, you get your wife, your dog, and your trailer back. I don't know if that's true, but that's what they say. Why are we wanting that? Why is that something we want? My God, let whatever you do in word or in deed, do it all in the name of Jesus Christ. Everything we do and everything we say ought to bring glory to the name of the Lord. It ought to declare the name of the Lord because we are no longer the people we used to be. We are new creatures. Old things have passed away. And behold, all things have become new. We are dead to sin, that we should no longer live therein. Sin shall not therefore reign over your mortal body. Ye through the Spirit do put to death the deeds of the flesh. Why do we want it? Has nothing to do with us. I've had people get mad at me because I didn't close down Sunday night service to watch the Super Bowl. Well, okay, you want to watch Beyonce stand in the middle of a pentagram and give, you know, a shout out to Satan? Go ahead. I don't want nothing to do with it. It has nothing to do with me. Why would I cancel church for sports? But it's because the church has left something very special. We've left that zeal of God. We've let that fire grow cold in us. But God's raising up a generation that's going to get it back because we want it. We're so hungry for the Lord. We're so hungry for the word of God and the fire of God. Whew, good God. And when it really comes, saints of God, it'll put to bed all these outliers out here that are using religious tactics to perform in front of people. We won't have to worry about none of that mess. It'll all just go to the wayside. Paul said, even as Jannes and Jambres, their folly will also be revealed. It'll mean nothing. We just have to get back to what's important, right? First things first, all right? I hope this has helped you. We're not there yet. We're on our way. Don't allow anti-Semitic feelings or thoughts in your spirit. Let them go if they're there. God said, I love them. I chose them above all the people of all the nations. He was my firstborn. He was the first out of humanity that God had chosen. He loves them. But they are rebellious and stiff-necked, and they're hard-hearted, and God is going to have to chastise them. But remember, it's all in love, to the intent that even though there'll be a third of the remnant left, that it remain in Israel, they'll call on his name. And when they do, he's coming. And we're going to set up the theocratic kingdom of God upon this earth, and Jesus Christ is going to sit in the throne of Jerusalem, and he's going to rule and reign. I hope this has helped you. I hope this has given you some information. All right, we're going to receive our tithes and our offerings. Amen. Church is worth it, man. The church is worth supporting it financially. I thank God for this place. And I don't say this to puff us up, but there are very few places you're going to hear what you heard tonight and the depth that you heard it. Let us love what God has given to us. And let us support it with our finances, also with our labor. Amen. Sister Chandra's got the school. She can always use help. We got cleaning on Saturday around here. We can always use help. We've got plenty of areas that we need people to work in. Kids church. Oh, man, we need some help in kids church. We do. But I'm just so thankful that God has given us a place to work. We serve one another. That's what we do because we're children of God. We serve one another by which every joint and every band supplies. All right? So let's give heartily. Let's give with all of our hearts. You in St. Louis, if you've got an offering, amen, it'd be a good time for you to bring it as well. But let's give to the Lord with all of our hearts. And then, saints of God, Brother Garrett will be here with us this Sunday. Looking forward to that. And he'll be with us, amen, through Wednesday. Xander is really excited about that. Father, we thank you so much for the honor and the opportunity we have had to be here tonight. We thank you for the words that we have heard. We thank you for your presence that we have felt. Now we pray in the name of Jesus that you would bless this offering. Bless it to the furtherance of your kingdom. Bless those that give. Bless them abundantly. Those, God, who are living in fear of giving, or those who are just living in outright rebellion against giving, I pray, God, that you would convict their hearts, Lord, and let them know that you are not a man that you should lie. If they give, you'll give back to them. You will not leave them. David said, I have been young and I am now old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken nor a seed begging bread. Help them to have that full confidence to give to you faithfully. And we'll give you praise and glory and honor for it all in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. All right, brothers, come. Let's receive this offering.
I can't count the times I've called your name some broken night. And you showed up and patched me up like you do every time. I get amnesia. I forget that you keep coming around. Yeah, ain't no way you ever. Come on.
I know y'all were enjoying it, but it is getting late, and I've tried to get the kids home early on Wednesday so they can get some sleep. That is important to me, and it's important to them, and I'm sure as parents it's important to you. All right, so we're going to have a Christmas play, and we are going to do the Christmas Carol, the Christian Christmas Carol. Don't look at me crazy. We already talked about this. But here's what we need. Here's what we need. We need some men. We need some men, all right? We need some. Adam, I know you're good at acting. Come on. I know you're good at acting. We need some men, all right? We need men. A lot of times we get a lot of women that will help in the plays, but we don't get a lot of men. And if you like to act and if you're married, you know you're good at it. You know it's the truth. You know it's the truth. I got a lot of brothers out here like, where's my wife? We need men to help to act. It's a great play, guys. It's a really awesome play. It is a Christian take on the Christmas Carol. And we did it back when I was, I think, a senior in high school. Chandra, I'm trying to sell this thing. I mean, why don't you torpedo it before we get it out the gate? Now, listen, if you can't sing, we will not require you to. We will, okay. Yes. If you can't sing, we will not require you. Well, we need men involved, all right? We need men because we're going to have different parts and stuff like that. And it was a really effective play. And it's a really awesome play. It really is. And there's not spirits and all that stuff. And he's not being visited by, it has to do with dreams. He's dreaming and he's being visited by these historical whatever. So, but I want you men to get involved in this. It could be an awesome outreach. If we've got a lot of folks now in the church. If we get enough help, we can have a pretty nice production of this. And it'll be wonderful. Please do not bring up anything else that's going to just absolutely kill this. Go ahead. There you go. There you go. Amen. We're twisting their arm. It's great. It's great. It's awesome. Knowing the terror of God, we persuade men. We do whatever we have to do. Him, all things to all men, amen. So, if we need men, we need a lot of men involved. If you want to help, please see Sister Chandra. If you don't want to help, please see Sister Chandra. We need help, all right? Transform Youth Group is going to be October the 14th, 1 to 4. Fall Festival, not Harvest Festival. Don't bring your kids here dressed up and expect them to get candy. We're not going to have candy bags. We're not going to have nothing to do with Halloween. Do not bring them here dressed up. All right? I would like your children to dress up in their favorite biblical character. Okay. All right. All right. Come see Sister Sean. We're going to have Fall Fest. It's going to be wonderful. And we're going to do it early enough to where, you know, it's not going to be super cold. But I would like to maybe if it gets a little dark, we have a big old fire. That'd be awesome. Bonfire. So that'll be on October the 27th. Pastor Appreciation, October 29th. Brother Ratibi's meeting in Atlanta is going to be November the 10th to the 11th. I know several of you have said you want to go. Anybody else wants to go, let me know. I'll send you the link to the hotel. And we'd love to have you. I mean, it's going to be a great time. Alberto Mauricio's grandfather needs our prayers. He is in the hospital with fluid on his lungs. We need to pray for him. Dana Jones, Sister Chandra's mom. Shonda's mom. It's close enough. All right. Don't get me messed. I say Chandra all day long. Say Chandra all day long. But Rosalind Evans and her family, her son's passed away. Want to pray for her. He passed away unexpectedly in his sleep. What a horrible thing for a parent to have to deal with, man. So let's pray for them. Terry and Adam's house got some pretty good news. And so we need it to sell. And God's opening the door for it to do that. Brother Jimmy? That's always wonderful. Man, that's terrible. Ugh. I've had that one time, and I don't ever want to have to deal with it again. Gwen Pendleton, who is, we've been praying for Sister Ashley and Sister Cindy Pendleton and those that come that normally sit back here. It's their Sister Cindy's sister. God has answered prayers. We sent that prayer cloth. Man, the next day she started improving. She is at home. Wow. That woman was in ICU. She was in trouble. She's at home. Thank God. God's still doing miracles. My dad and his continued healing, Michelle Ketron, in her recovery, Brother Shannon Baldwin. Brother Johnny Mullen's going to go see him tomorrow. Looking forward to that, but we're going to keep him in prayer. Xander and his continued recovery, knee surgery. He's doing really well. He's got physical therapy starting Monday, but he's doing really well. So we thank God for that. We believe God has worked for him. Brother Denny Livingston and Lydia Bissett in their battles with cancer. So let's pray for all that. Miss everybody who would not be here tonight and those who could not be here tonight. But we pray that God will convict those who would not and that God will give opportunity for those who could not. Amen. But otherwise, let's pray. We'll be dismissed. Father, we thank you so much. We thank you. Lord, our hearts are indicting a good matter. Our tongue is as a pen of a ready writer. We're so grateful for the opportunity we have had to be in your house tonight. Now we pray in the name of Jesus, God, that you would be with us, oh God, that you would watch over us and keep us as we leave this place. Never your presence. God, help us to be better Christians. Help us to be brighter lights, God, in this dark world. Father, I pray for every request, God, whether it's comfort, strength, healing, correction, whatever, Lord, those are needing, that we have lifted up, Lord God, their names in request, God. We pray that you would meet every need according to your riches in glory by Christ Jesus, Lord. Now guide us, keep us, help us, strengthen us, God. Challenge us and change us, God. Lord, as we leave this place, God, we pray that you would protect every one of us, God. Keep us from accident and incident. Keep us safe until we come back at the next appointed time. And in Jesus' name we pray all of these things. Amen. All right. God bless you guys. Have a great, great rest of the week. We'll see you Sunday. 10 o'clock cleaning on Saturday. So please, everybody that can be here, thank you guys for coming. We're having a good turnout, great turnouts. So we thank you so much for those that are showing up. Thank you for your faithfulness.